Put Hello. Down the PDA, dipshit.
So you two, this movie kind of came out of a love affair between the two of you, I gather.
Not true.
More like, as David says, I was stalking him and he was trying to fend me off, but...
Well, he wanted to make a movie about the media sort of change or meltdown, depending on your perspective. And he said, you know, I'd like to be over your shoulder. And I said, great, go talk to my bosses, thinking I'll just rub him off that way. I had seen his other two movies and liked them a lot, but the idea of him having Andrew's big cow eyes staring at me for a long, long time didn't appeal to me all that much. And and somehow he talked my bosses into it, and we spent like 4 days together, and I said, dude, you need some other characters. I'm not going to be able to do my job, even if you get your movie, which I was totally doubtful that he could make a movie out of it. And but you got to get some other people involved because I can't have you looking at me all the time.
So how many days did you end up actually shooting? How many people, how many days?
I basically was shooting for about 14 months, and it was usually 3 days a week, sometimes more, sometimes less, over the course of a year. It's basically from 2009 to the end of 2010.
So I went, when I went to South by Southwest, he was there. When I went to the iPad unveil, he was there. It was kind of like a buddy movie, except we really hate each other.
So is there a lot of Dave Carr on the floor, on the cutting room floor?
On the
cutting
room floor.
Are there David Carr stories that are not told?
You know, there's a ton of stuff that's on the cutting room floor. I mean, you know, whenever you do a Verite doc that's like, you know, 200 hours of footage, of course you're going to get a lot on the floor. But also we did a lot of sit-down interviews with some really fascinating people who've got really interesting views on journalism. Emily Bell, who's at Columbia. Let's see, they're all, I'm forgetting them all right now, but there are about 15 of them. Right. So, I mean, and other sort of characters at the time, so we also tried to follow, and we really just focused in, we zeroed in on the people at the media desk. And so that's David, Brian Stelter, Tim Arango, who's now going to be the Baghdad bureau chief, and Bruce Hedlum, who's the editor for the whole desk.
So is that how you went into it? Is that what you thought when you went into it, or...?
Yes, I mean, I initially I was thinking it would be more about David,
right.
But it was always supposed to be a play within a play,
right?
Which may sound pretentious, but
it does,
and David's always checking me on that. But I think that you just have this unique sort of like device, which is the stories that all these guys are reporting that tell us about the media landscape, but they themselves have these huge stakes because the paper that they're working at is suffering or potentially overcoming many of the same challenges that they're writing about. So
it's interesting because this group happens to be kind of like the hero group at the paper at this point. I mean, it's a beat that is the hottest beat. And, you know, these are the guys who aren't going to go anywhere because unless they're going to Iraq.
Well, you know, David says often that, you know, it's not like they're reporting on, you know, genocide all the time or you know, war or... Gretchen Morgenson, as you were referring to today, who's, you know, reported on the collapse of the economy. However, it for the purposes of the film, their beat, which is covering, you know, the emergence of tablets and the death of traditional sort of outlets, is just the perfect prism to see everything
it's,
through.
It's great strength as a film is its sort of... weakness in terms of the wider world, because if you put a keyhole on the New York Times and go to the most important thing, it probably wouldn't land on media. I mean, when Katrina happened, they sent the architecture critic and the gossip columnist before I went. So my mission criticalness is not writ. It's a very hot year. I mean, my wife saw the film. And she said, I can't believe how lucky he got on the timing. I said, well, I think he saw something cresting. And he, you know, he worked hard. Yeah, he got lucky. Story. He did a lot of WikiLeaks stuff, which is obviously breaking right now. In terms of, you know, media is meta on meta. You know, we write about things about people who write about things, about people who actually do things. So we're a little removed from the actual world, which gave me doubts about how are you really going to make a movie out of that. But all of the sort of first act, second act, third act, narrative conceits of filmmaking are present. I mean, I so doubted. You've been in a lot of newsrooms, David, and you know, they're not intrinsically interesting places. They look like insurance companies. There's no more printing presses. It's a lot of doughy white people who look like me or probably better. And you think, not great cinematic terrain. And it's, you know, a tribute to Andrew. He made an actual movie out of it. I think when you do see it, you'll agree. It's a film.
Well, I think only the title is slightly misleading. Because it really is. It's like, it feels that you get a lot of the paper in. The overall is there. It seems like about 20% of the movie. And 80% seems to be the media desk. Which is fascinating. I mean, it really works as a movie. It's a terrific movie. But it's... You know, it doesn't feel like you really tried to get, you know, the 20-hour version of the entire New York Times and the history of the paper.
Yeah, but think of the access of this is what stuns me is, like, every documentarian, he's just like, oh, I only want this teeny little slice. And there's the layoffs.
Right.
There's Bill Keller saying, I feel like I should have a butcher's apron on. And I'm like, you cunning little dude. Look, he just... wormed his way in, weaseled his way in, and hung out. The sort of conceits of narrative journalism, which is if you stay put long enough, great things will occur, I think are manifest in what he ended up shooting.
I agree. I think the movie is a great representation of why journalism, proper journalism, still matters. I mean, I think it defines the fact that the conversations that are had around the editor or two or three reporters hanging out together discussing a story is kind of what all of us who are not in that situation, not at those newspapers, kind of dream about being able to do. Because it's going to make you a better journalist. It's going to make better copy.
I think one of the subtexts of the film is it's sort of a fight song or love song for editors, which, you know, you could say, oh, that sounds interesting. But in an age when we can all just shoot information out via blog, via Twitter, sometimes it's nice to have somebody in the middle saying, wait a minute, let's think this through. There's a part in the film about NBC, and this I didn't really agree with Andrew to start, but now I understand about them declaring the end of the war. Mm-hmm. And editors after asking questions about, well, who decided that the war is ending? Mm-hmm. And eventually deciding, you know what? Here's the story we're going to do. No story. That's what we're doing because nothing's happening here. It's a great moment.
Nobody spikes anything on the internet.
And the other great editing moment, and you could identify with this in your job, is Brian Stelter sitting there typing away, and Bruce says, you sent it right, and Brian is, yeah, I sent it. And and he continues to type, and Bruce says, you really sent it? Yeah, sure, yeah, I sent it. And he just pivots, turns and looks at the camera and goes, he's lying. And that's the times, that's everywhere, which is Brian is trying hard to make it better. Mm-hmm. Bruce is trying to perform the daily miracle. There is a level of sort of built-in conflict there in the relationship. And there is something, for anybody who's in the newsroom, that's got to be the greatest moment in the film when the editor turns and goes, he's lying.
And he's right.
He is. And I think Bruce is like, he's the beau ideal of an editor. He's in the film, he's like this kind of short Cary Grant character. And he's good with the words, good with talking through stories. God help you if you want an email answered. But he's got the great bedside manner. Mm-hmm. He can do punch up in the copy, and you think, anybody who's watching the film closely would go, you know, I think part of the reason that I find Brian Stelter or David Carr readable is he's got this guy helping him along.
So how does everybody continue to fight the fight of, you know, because Koss, I guess, says it in the movie the most effectively or most directly, and is dead wrong as far as I'm concerned, but it, you know, this idea that everybody's a journalist, everybody's adding to the picture, that's a good thing, somehow that's the answer, versus this fairly expensive, because you're talking about five bodies actually thinking about something as a group. The hive mind that, you know, you actually talk about the hive mind on Twitter all the time. There's a hive mind at the New York Times.
Yes.
And it requires five people who know the beat, who are interested in the beat, who care. The conversations you guys have in the movie are complex. They're not simplistic or, you know, just did this one lie to you or not tell, you know, it's like, how do we all fight that? Or do, is the New York Times arrogance really a requirement of just saying, fuck you, we do it this way, we're gonna try to keep doing it this way because this is the right way to do it?
Well, if you go on our page one meeting, it's an interesting, Andrew Schutz in the page one meeting. These guys are all deciding, they're manufacturing a hierarchy of values mm-hmm. at that point, and they're making judgments. The whole time they're talking, and it wasn't in the movie, the web is above them in mm-hmm. real time, our front page. And these stories they're talking about as if they're writ mm-hmm. and done are morphing and alighting and moving up and down and, mm-hmm. and sideways. And so I think that that's much more of a negotiation. Sort of the difference, being on page one is a big deal, but boy, being on that most viewed list, mm-hmm. really a big deal. And that's decided by our audience, decided by algorithm, you know, it's not.
But is four of you having the conversation instead of five of you a diminution of everything that comes out of that department, that area of the paper?
I think actually that, you know, what the film, I think, hopes to present is that we do need a couple of organizations at least that are that rigorously going through the information to filter it, to see what is true or what is not. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there is a little bit of a sort of how many New York Times journalists does it take to screw in a light bulb kind of feeling, but ultimately...
The answer is a lot.
A lot, but I mean, yeah. Ultimately that's why you have either a story that is so rigorously reported and so reliable, or the absence of a story, and that's really what that
Although,
particular
scene is
about.
Although, to be fair, he points out several times when that broke down in fundamental ways, the Jason Blair incident, Judith Miller, and so it's hardly foolproof. It does have an annealing effect mm-hmm. on your work, and a lot of times it's maddening, and it's trying to push things through Jell-O, you know, to make them happen. But eventually what pops up, it generally stands. I did a big story this year, and you know, it was really, really hard to manage the source relationship on one hand, which mm-hmm. was the Tribune Company, and the New York Times on the other, and somehow sit between those two things. But I'm very happy with what popped out. I just want to wipe out from my memory what it was like to be in the middle of that.
Well, you take a club to Newser and to Michael Wolff pretty good in the movie, but then Ariana gets off kind of light, I think. She actually is given a little more credibility because she's very much in the same position where she really is living off of the New York Times and many other papers.
You're right, and we might need to revisit that.
I think it's her accent that baffled him.
I mean, I sort of feel like her comments, although, you know, astute, you know, like her saying that, like, the future is a linked economy, and mm-hmm. if you can't find your way to that, then you can't find your way. That might be true, but I think it's sort of like the heartlessness of that comment that we try and pick up on in the film.
Yeah, but the reason she looks so good is because of who's asking the questions. John Kerry.
Which is John Kerry, right? This is a congressional...
Being incredibly pompous. Committed.
Well, there's an arrogance. I mean, when's the last time the Huffington Post actually broke anything? I mean, it's not, and they want to. I mean, there are people on the web like myself who generally are not in the breaking business, but she is and doesn't break anything. And the idea of a Huffington Post reporter doing much more than reading the New York Times and retyping it is as unlikely as anything else.
Which
and
is yet, what David Simon says.
But yet there is a kind of deference, and we see it again with Gawker in this particular movie, where there's kind of like a bowing to Denton at the idea that they're actually producing news, because they're not producing news either, and they're not even that big a business, really.
I think you missed something. I mean, he dwells on the big board where it's so-and-so topless, so-and-so.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that what this film is trying to do is sort of let people speak for themselves, right? Mm-hmm. So you basically, you've got a year inside the Times looking at the media desk reporting, and it's up to you to decide, do you think that sort of the conversations they're having and their way that they're doing their jobs is something admirable that is worth, you know, paying for online, or, you know, sort of generally being something that we aspire to or not. And I think the same goes for Nick when mm-hmm. he's talking about the big board and saying that, you know, these are the most popular stories and people don't care about Albany corruption stories. Well, you know, what you do see on the big board there is, you know, condoms with teeth found in Africa mm-hmm. or, you know, Helen Mirren going topless. So I think that the film's voice is trying to not preach to you and tell you what to think.
He's dead wrong about the Albany stories, too. I mean, our Spitzer stories ended up being huge. And you don't get those stories unless you stay put. What I always say to Ariana, what I always say to Denton is, you know, that's great, your business model of aggregation or stealing, depending on how you look at it, is wonderful. Somebody's got to make those phone calls. Mm-hmm. And I think the fact that you see a lot of reporters using very different styles, working the phones, and you know, you see people like crossing their fingers or kissing butt to make things happen or going super aggro on the phone. That I think this sort of, you know, somebody has to hit those digits, call people up, and make it happen. In that sense, it's reporting, I think, plays a very central role in the film.
Well, we see kind of the same dichotomy here at the festival, and maybe even on this film. I don't know whether you've sold it yet or what your plans are, but, you know, the question becomes not whether it's a good film, not whether people would like the film if they saw it, but how much will marketing cost, and can they make their money back? How many DVDs can you sell? And you tend to lose in the film business right now as we go through this clenching of our buttocks, the focus on what's good and versus what is saleable. And so it's not foreign even to going to Sundance that this is happening. The question is, how do you come up with a model that will, you know, and that seems to be a question in the movie as well, and it doesn't seem to be answered. And I sometimes think that David and others at that media desk kind of are looking for that model with great deal of hope, like scratching at the, you know, they're willing to look through, you know, Vibe magazine or whatever to try to find some way, because ultimately the New York Times has to do that also.
There's actually, I think, a quote in the film from Katrina Vandenhuvel of The Nation, where she says, if anybody tells you what the media business is going to look like in 5 years, don't buy a bridge from them. I mean, I think I would never presume to tell people what the answer is, what the model is. I think the sort of imperative that I hope people come away from is that there is a place for what the Times does, and we should not take it for granted. And so that's what I think we're hoping to show, is like, this is a look inside. You read that paper, you sort of think, you get that, you know, gray and black and white object, but what is it that's behind it, and what would happen if it went away?
The film only sort of flicks at this, but it used to be bifurcated. Here's new media, here's old media or legacy media. But there's been this creeping toward each other, wherein, you know, we have 70 blogs. Once every 4 seconds, somebody Twitters out a New York Times story. We have 2.8 million followers on Twitter, 48 million people who visit us on the web. And so, you know, we've had this sort of Frankenstein and blind violinist moment where we're like feeling each other's faces and going, friend, are you here to kill me? And whereas you have, you know, Denton's actually hired a couple of reporters. Mm-hmm. Ariana has funded an investigative unit, and I'm same as you, where's the beef?
Yeah.
What's going on with it? But they realize the killer app news. If you, you know, you've had some breaks on your site, just the velocity of people pointing toward you, the fire hose opening up. And so having something that someone else doesn't is so far superior to doing your bit of annotation on what's in plain sight.
So are you looking for a model? I mean, do you feel compelled to find the model for the paper on some level?
I got pulled in a little bit on discussions about what was going on. It terrified me because I thought, if they're listening to me, unless they're doing it to listen carefully and go the other way, they're in a lot of trouble. I'm actually a bit of a bull on the metered model, and it's partly because it won't cost me any visibility as a writer. Our plan is to set a meter back 10 stories, 20 stories, where we can still have the majority of our drive-by traffic, but then people will bump into a wall at a certain frequency and be asked, and those are the people that are using us the most. One of the things that I think about is when you have people behind that wall, that's also a new advertising business because it takes us out of the commodity business where we're competing with Huffington Post, where we're competing with Daily Beast. Because what they do is replicate our audience away from us and puts us into a new world of we know about these people, mm-hmm. we know what they're doing, they've opted in, and maybe we can begin to sell premium against yeah. that.
The only question I always have on that is price point. I mean, that's for me, as somebody who's paid for their Wall Street Journal online for, you know, a decade, at $80 a year, basically.
Seems like a pretty good value, doesn't
yes.
it?
Yes, and but there was some report that $20 a month was what you guys were thinking about, which seems a little scary.
I'm trying to not let either eyebrow move, so I actually don't know.
So what about David Carr as an icon? Because that certainly is part of this movie and the experience last night at the screening where, you know, the audience got up on their feet the second you came out. It was like you know, Jesus had walked into the room.
I thought that was so weird because I watch it and, you know, I don't really know that I walk over bent over all the time. And I don't know how horrible my voice sounds until I hear it over and over again. And then my daughter watched the movie and she said, Dad, you are such a thug. I mean, you're just yelling at people all the time. And so what I see is basically sort of a homeless guy walking around with a pencil and a piece of paper. Other people respond to, and I think part of it is I clearly have kind of an immigrant's love of the place. And anybody who comes for it, I'm going to try and lay them low. And so that's... you know that from personal experience that and I'm very tribal in my loyalty. So to come for the institution is to come for me. Part of what's a little weird for me is like there are actual real heroes at the place. Mm-hmm. You know, we've got Tyler Hicks over in Afghanistan shooting at great personal peril. Chris mm-hmm. Chivers going into places where he should not be. My colleague, Tim Arango, going into Baghdad where the threat is so asymmetric, you just never know where to mm-hmm. stand. You have people who've been on beats for 20 and 30 years. And so I think when they respond to me, part of what they're responding to is in part is, this is sort of what a reporter looks like. We're not really a beautiful species. We're never going to win any fashion awards, but we care desperately about getting it right.
But you also have a voice. I mean, you yourself, I mean, since Carpetbagger and going back to the media column full time, really, primarily, there is a David Carr voice that people attach to. There is a humanity and an honesty that you comes through your tweets, that comes through your columns, that it doesn't feel different than the Times, but feels... people do connect to you in a very personal way, or do you not feel this?
Yeah, partly because, you know, I did this book, and so that's...
That's true.
But the thing is if, let's use Twitter as an example. I have like 290,000 followers. You know, that's great, that's really impressive. If my last name was not New York Times, mm-hmm. I think it'd be 290, I do. And so you have to look at, it's the hybrid sort of mashed up mm-hmm. brand that is working. And in terms of, you know, that people always say to me, well, how can you write that at the New York Times? Or who'd... I've never had anybody step toward me and say, mm-hmm. you ought to think about giving this a rest, or you ought to think about, there's an accommodation of idiosyncrasy. I mean, if you walk into mm-hmm. our room, yes, there's a lot of ivy, mm-hmm. there's a lot of smart people, but then there's all these sort of misfit toys like me too that have found a place.
Well, I think that's really kind of one of the appeals of David is that, you know, there's this image of the Times man, mm-hmm. As we saw in that Alistair Cook clip that's in the film. From 1954, depicting, you know, Turner Catledge, one of the storied, you know, chief editors of the New York Times, and all the people sitting around the desk, and they're all wearing suspenders, and, you know, they look like so straight-laced. But from that sort of mountaintop, we have come to expect great journalism and great insight into the world. Mm-hmm. So take that sort of set of standards and quality, but then put it in the body of somebody like David, who's gone through so much in his personal life, and has a sense of humor and a sort of a lack of sort of bowing down to authority, mm-hmm. and suddenly you have this really fresh voice, and I think that's what people are connecting
to.
The
other thing is there's these versions, Brian Stelter, 24 years old, digital native, came from a blog. We have this running sort of bromance between us, right? And we couldn't be more different. He produces and consumes content in the same synthetic act, and every time he moves his elbow, a story pops out of it. That is so not me. But I have so much sort of admiration for him, but I never want to be him. This morning, and yes, in fact, we are roommates at Sundance for at least a night. He's under his blankets, but I can see he's awake and moving, and so I get a little nervous. He's a young man after all, and I'm hoping he doesn't have company or, and then I see the power cord up under the blanket. And so my first words of the day is, Stelter, are you tweeting under there? And he said, yes. 7 in the morning, he's been asleep for 3 hours. There he is.
But, you know, there is something about your personality and everything that, as you were saying a second ago, that nobody's told you to stop being you. Do you think they've become used to, have they wanted you to be more you as you've gone along? I mean, Carpetbagger, I think the movie beat and the entertainment beat tends to be the least edited, frankly. I mean, we had this argument before, but I have issues often with some of that coverage because I feel like it's not as chewed over as what I saw in the movie last night. I wish it were. From the New York Times, and many, and New York Times is not certainly not the worst of it, but I expect the most from the New York Times. But that's where your personality really started to emerge as a factor, I think, at the paper and on the line. And then you went back to your media column as a full-time thing. Did they want you to be more David Carr?
Well, part of the reason, I mean, I love.
I can see you in the op-ed pages now. I mean, I can see you becoming one of those people.
You know what's funny about that is I don't read the op-ed pages, so I probably would not be a good. We live in a sort of fact-rich environment, and there's such a fire hose of data coming at it. In spite of the fact that I write a column, I still try and do stories. I still do movie stories. I did the Coen Brothers. I did Michael Shannon. I have some other ones coming up. Part of the reason I left the movie beat is I was feeling myself sucked into the Borg, starting to care about what people thought of me, starting to wonder, be strategic in sort of how I approach things. And everybody shows up at the movie beat thinking, I will change this. I will be the one who brings some rigor and some seriousness to this because it's such a poorly behaved industry. And then 4 months later, they get found on the side of Wilshire Boulevard with their panties at their ankles, wondering what happened to them. And the annealing forces tend to go, the industry wears you out. They pick you up and use you to the extent that they want and then set you back down. And when you commit journalism, they totally freak out. Mm-hmm. And because you've interrupted the sort of marketing narrative, you've been through this a lot of the film, and or you've somehow pulled back the blankets on one corner they didn't want you to see. And I love movies. I'm frantic about movies. And so I always want to be the guy in the third row. I'm the least critical watcher of films you'll ever see. Always there with the popcorn, watching the previews and thinking it's just going to be great. And I'm so stunned when it isn't. I'm so surprised and disappointed. And I didn't really, the only way I can sort of switch off from what I do, and I'm far too plugged in and work too much and all that, is to sit literally in a movie theater in the dark with other people. And I felt like I was, like some of the magic was going away. You know, you've been watching it for a long time. You start to see all the wires and everything you watch, and it was sad for me.
So, thank you. do you think that the more personality you were putting into that was something that your editors encouraged, or is it just the happenstance of how they edit you? Because somebody has to be saying yes for you to be who you are.
You keep coming back to this question. I think it is an important one, so I'll try and answer it. Let's take my, I wrote a book about, I was an addict, I was a drunk, I did all these things. So I write the book, and I give it to my editors with a pair of like oven mitts, right? and you know, really worried about what they're going to think. I did report out everything in the book. I did interviews and stuff. And then when I put the nut cup on to go and talk to them about it, they're like, this is fine. Meets our standards. We don't hire nuns. And I'm like, really? And it seemed fine. I think more and more of the Times is comfortable with individual brands, be it be it Brian Stelter, be it Gretchen Morgenson, be it
Sorkin,
they built out a whole vertical around them, or Willie Rashbaum, who does these long metro heaves. And they realize we're in where more and more media is becoming a federation of individual brands under an umbrella. You can't forget with the umbrella how important it is, though.
Yeah. So are you in the process of selling? Is that the activities?
We basically are, and probably today should have an announcement. So
that's exciting.
Yeah, we're. I mean,
Sundance.
Do you
see his blushing a little bit?
Because you got too much money. Is that the? Are you upset?
No. I just think that the form of release will hopefully really amplify the conversation that's in this movie, and that, you know, it can be in theaters, and it can sort of live hopefully over the course of the summer, in a kind of cultural conversation that people can really talk about. What is the future of journalism for us, and what do we care about, and, you know, what do these assorted writers at the Times tell us about, you know,
if when we leave about. Here, instead of schlepping up the block, a big black Lincoln,
right, there's a limousine, the documentary limousine is going to be
pulling up. You'll know that somebody's giving him some sugar.